Part 4, Style and Language of Shakespeare. Shakespeare's mercy and compassion, his sense of justice, and his belief in the inherent dignity of man pervade and illuminate his plays. What distinguishes them, then, from other searching studies of human nature and conduct?
The answer lies not only in Shakespeare's understanding of humanity, but also in the power of the literary vehicle with which he conveys his brilliant interpretation of man and his place in the universe. The vehicle of style and language.
The essence of Shakespeare's style is a compound of brilliant rhythms, word music, vivid imagery, subtle overtones, and precision and concreteness of language. In his hands, blank verse becomes a fluid, living instrument. There is flexibility in its many run-on lines, psychological impact in his dramatic pauses. There is poetic unity in his richly sustained metaphors, and there is freedom of movement to tell a story, set a mood or background, or paint a vivid word picture. Note, for example, the rocking rhythms, the alliteration, and the long vowels that combine to produce the effect of the swell and surge of the sea. The speaker is the invisible Ariel, telling Ferdinand in song that his father lies drowned.
Full fathom five thy father lies, of his bones are coral made. Those are pearls that were his eyes, nothing of him that doth fade, but doth suffer a sea change into something rich and strange. Sea nymphs hourly ring his knell. Hark, now I hear them. Ding dong bell.
Note, too, the skillfully suggestive overtones, the unspoken thoughts, and Macbeth's reactions to the news of his wife's death.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death.
Macbeth, pausing dramatically after the words dusty death, concludes with a vivid metaphor taken directly from Shakespeare's own stage background.
Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
What a challenge to the imagination. What profound philosophy lie in Portia's luminous remark to Nerissa in The Merchant of Venice.
How far that little candle throws his beams. So shines a good deed in a naughty world.
Or let your fancy play on the rich imagery evoked by the rogue Autolycus, singing the contents of his peddler's pack in the shepherd's cottage in the play The Winter's Tale.
Lawn as white as driven snow, cypress black as e'er was crow, gloves as sweet as damask roses, masks for faces and for noses, bugle bracelet, necklace amber, perfume for a lady's chamber, golden coifs and stomachers for my lads to give their dears, pins and poking sticks of steel, what maids lack from head to heel. Come buy of me, come buy, come buy, buy, lads, or else your lasses cry. Come buy.
Shakespeare's plays are full of such striking images. On plant and animal life, time, light and dark, earth, sea, sky, war, disease, death, in fact, almost every aspect of human experience.
The basis of Shakespeare's style and thought is keenness of observation, beauty and precision of language, and imaginativeness of concept. All these are blended in his famous comparison of the seven ages of man to acts unfolding on a stage. The passage is an extended metaphor or comparison, elaborating the opening line, all the world's a stage, to encompass the major cycles of life. The melancholy Jaques, replying to Duke Senior in the play As You Like It, delivers the lines.
All the world's a stage, and all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances, and one man in his time plays many parts, his acts being seven ages. At first the infant mewling and puking in the nurse's arms, Then the whining schoolboy with his satchel and shining morning face creeping like snail unwillingly to school. And then the lover sighing like furnace with a woeful ballad made to his mistress' eyebrow. Then the soldier, full of strange oaths and bearded like the pard, jealous in honor, sudden and quick in quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation even in the cannon's mouth. Then the justice, in fair round belly with good capon lined, with eyes severe and beard a formal cut, full of wise saws and modern instances, and so he plays his part. The sixth age shifts into the lean and slippered pantaloon, with spectacles on nose and pouch on side. His youthful hose well saved, a world too wide for his shrunk shank, and his big manly voice, turning again towards childish treble, pipes and whistles in his sound. The last scene of all that ends this strange, eventful history is second childishness and mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything.
Shakespeare's style and magic are unmistakable. Even in plays of disputed authorship, like Timon of Athens and Pericles, the passages attributed to Shakespeare stand out from the rest in the power, the beauty, and the dignity of the lines. For Shakespeare's style bears the hallmark of genius.